This is a download from BFM 89.9, the business station.
Good morning and welcome back to The Morning Run. I'm Roshan Kanasin with Lynn Mark and Noel Lim in the studio this morning. Let's talk about Pumuli, the stimulus package we got out yesterday evening from the government, because Prime Minister Tan Sri Muhyiddin Yassin announced the 150 billion ringgit aid package to be channeled towards low and middle income households affected by the ongoing COVID-19 crisis.
So this is the largest package by the PN government since the 250 billion ringgit Prihatin package announced in March last year, when the country first went into a lockdown. In a televised address, Muhyiddin said the relief package would involve 10 billion ringgit in direct fiscal injection. This includes cash payments to households considered hardcore poor, getting 1,300, 800 or 800 ringgit for B40 household and 250 ringgit for M40 households.
Yes, and of course, I'm very interested to know what they're going to be doing with EPF. So EPF members will be allowed to withdraw up to 5,000 ringgit over a period of 5 months under a new facility, iCitra. And Muhyiddin also announced a six-month loan moratorium for all individual borrowers, whether from the B40, M40 or T20. As well as micro entrepreneurs without conditions.
But the big question is, are these initiatives enough? And what is the long-term impact of this Pumuli package? For more on this, we're speaking with Dr. Carmelo Felito, CEO of the Centre for Market Education. Carmelo, a very good morning to you and thank you for joining us. Now, one of the main highlights of the government's Pumuli package is the special cash assistance, which ranges from 100 ringgit to 1,300 ringgit for the absolute poor to the M40s. What's your general thoughts on this particular part of the package? Carmelo, are you on?
Good morning.
There we go.
Good morning. Yeah, sorry.
no worries.
You know, my general thought, I have a preliminary thought, is that these kind of measures, similarly like the lockdown for the medical emergency, should be considered something temporary that we adopt to buy time. And meanwhile, we implement broader strategy to bring the country back on track. But unfortunately, what I see now is that we have made this measure something permanent that is there to stay without the more general plan for the reopening of the economy, for getting the country back on track. So I do believe that these measures can represent a sort of relief, in particular for the poor, at a very limited extent, however. And I wonder how long can we sustain this kind of temporary measures that are becoming permanent measures. Because you see, there is, for the people, okay, for a certain number of weeks or months, they can do with aid. But now we are talking about a situation which is lasting since 1.5 years almost. And furthermore, there is another broader issue, which is the dignity of people. I mean, I think that what people need and want, both from an economic perspective and a psychological individual perspective, is to go back to work, to regain their dignity as human beings, and earn money not because the government is giving out charity, but because they do something for themselves, their family and the society.
So, Carmelo, I mean, one of the other features that the government is once again allowing Malaysians to do is to withdraw from the EPF up to 5,000 ringgit via the iCitra scheme. What are your thoughts on this? Is this a good move?
Well, as you maybe remember, I've been in favor of this move when it was first introduced last year, but I become skeptical as these measures is renewed and prolonged. It could have been helpful at the very beginning, but now we should wonder how many people still have money in the EPF, and how much do they have in the EPF, and how much are we compromising their long-term financial stability by allowing them to do so. Of course, people that still have resources there, they need these resources to survive, but at which cost? And again, with no real exit strategy from these temporary measures. So I wonder that, I believe that we may have a higher cost than the benefit with this measure.
The loan moratorium is automatic for the poor and micro entrepreneurs. No conditions, just apply and get it for 6 months. What is your view about this?
It's similar to the one on the EPF withdrawal. Again, I've been in favor of the loan moratorium at the beginning, but I don't think that it should be further prolonged, and it should be left to a case-by-case scenario decided by banks. Of course, also banks, they don't have great interest in the default of their customers. They need to get their money back. But we need also to be sure that we preserve the financial stability of the country.
Now, Camillo, earlier you noted these seem to be measures we go back to over and over again. All that once was seemingly temporary, but has become more relied upon since the pandemic started 1.5 years ago at this point. More and more, we're looking at this becoming endemic to society in the longer run. And you noted earlier that we need to be looking at broader measures. Now, what do you mean by broader measures? What should we be looking at? What's missing in Pumule?
Well, I think that what is missing not only in this package, but in the general, if you want to call strategy of the government, is indeed a strategy. You know, what was announced was that we need to wait for the cases to be below a certain threshold in order to do this and to do that. This is not a strategy. This is a wait and see. So I think that we should move in a totally different direction, which is like also Singapore announced, think to live with the virus and strengthen the capability to handle the virus from the medical perspective, from the healthcare perspective, because otherwise we are transferring too much the healthcare crisis into the general social and economic system. So my idea is that we should really develop a plan for the economy to reopen independently from the number of cases, but investing resources not in charity packages, but in strengthening the healthcare system, improving our medical research, improving our medical facilities, and boosting the capability for businesses in particular to do mass and frequent testing. That is something I think I mentioned several times. Now, the real key is to be able to tackle, to identify positive cases at the early stage, and you can do that only by testing, I would say, on a weekly basis, all employees and staff in the workplaces and schools. This is, I think, I'm not saying we should not spend money, but we should spend money for something that give us the possibility to go back as much as possible to a normal life.
So looking at the measures that have been announced thus far, Carmelo, what kind of long-term impact do you think we can expect from them?
I think that we have several problems here. First of all, it's not really clear how these measures will be further financed. So the risk is that national debt may further increase, in particular at the light of the fact that GDP is not going to grow this year. Together with this, there is the shifting of this burden on future generations, so the lack of opportunities for our children, basically. And I also believe that there is a great risk in inflationary pressures that is coming with this further fiscal injection, which may erode further the purchasing power of the people. So people may have the impression to have more money in hand, more cash in hands, but the actual value of their cash in hands is diminished. So we have a monetary illusion. And now inflationary pressures are kept low because we are within an economic crisis. So we have, on the other side, deflationary pressures. But in the moment in which we are out of the crisis, and only God knows when, we may have a little bit of out of control inflation. And this could push the central bank to tighten monetary policy and therefore to frustrate the economic recovery when the economic recovery will start to happen. So we may encounter a post-COVID economic crisis. And this is a scenario that we are still in time to avoid, but we need to act now with a completely different strategy.
Carmelo, thank you so much for your time. As always, that was Dr. Carmelo Felito, CEO for the Center for Market Education, giving us his thoughts on the Pumule package. And I think long story short, there was his points come back down to what were temporary plans have become something that we've gone back to over and over again. Instead of a broader plan or strategy to address the issues that could come into play going forward, right? Like, you need to put cash in hands and you need to help people out. But what's the longer term plan for this? We can't be having 2 years of this going on, which will be the situation at the end of this year.
Yeah, so we need something more sustainable, as he has alluded. Because COVID is going to be here to stay, right? So we can't just be, you know, giving this very knee-jerk kind of stimulus. Mm. And we have to really start seriously thinking about how to slowly open the economy. Like, can we just now just allow dining at least for two people?
I think a lot of the measures that the government has announced have been very reactionary, and not just to the pandemic, but to backlash as well from the public. So the problem there is that more of your effort goes towards firefighting the symptoms rather than addressing the root cause of the problem, right? So we need more proactive, long-term planning from the government. And if there is that long-term planning, perhaps you might be so kind as to tell us more about it.
Yeah, I'm citing a story here on Malaysia Kini from Bernama, actually, where Dr. Sri Azmin Ali says that 75% of the COVID-19 cases are sporadic and not generally coming from the manufacturing sector, as we've come to believe, which means that we're going to have to learn how to live with COVID-19 as it becomes more likely endemic over time. At BFM 89.9.
Thank you for listening to this podcast. To find more great interviews, go to bfm.my or find us on iTunes. BFM 89.9, the business station.